Okay, we've all heard the saying, numbers don't lie. They are abstract, concrete concepts defined in complete certainty. If you have three rocks, you don't sort of have three rocks, you actually have exactly three rocks. No ambiguity there. But can numbers be misleading? Are there situations in which numbers can appear to be lying to us? Say we have a hypothetical drug trial to treat a certain disease. The ultimate question is, does this drug help people recover? There were 400 participants, each of whom is sick with this disease. To keep all variables balanced, half the participants were male and the other half were female. In addition, the drug was randomly assigned to half the participants, where the other half got a placebo. So far, so good. Let's take a look at the results of this trial. Of the 200 people who got the real drug, 100 of them recovered from the disease. Out of the other half who got the placebo, only 80 of them recovered. It looks as though this is an effective drug, since the data indicate that taking this drug will improve your chances of recovering from 40% to 50%. But not so fast. Let's take a closer look. For the male participants, 50 ended up with the drug, 10 of whom actually recovered from the disease. The other 150 got the placebo, only 45 of whom recovered. For the female participants, 150 ended up getting the drug, 90 of whom recovered. The other 50 got the placebo, 35 of whom recovered. So, although the drug has a positive effect overall, the drug will actually decrease your chances of recovering if you are male, and it will decrease your chances of recovering if you are female. Wait, what? If you are male, the drug does harm. If you are female, the drug does harm. That already covers everyone in this trial, yet overall the drug does good? Welcome to Simpson's Paradox. In certain situations, a trend in individual groups of data can change or even reverse after combining that same data. What could this trial really be saying? Does this drug actually help people recover from this disease? Seriously, think about it. Do we take the data representative of everybody, telling us the drug does good? Or do we take the data for each individual sex, telling us the drug does harm? This set of data does not answer our question. Here's why. Notice that the male participants happen to have lower chances of recovering compared to females, regardless of being given the drug or not. And look, most of the people who got the drug are female. More of the drug were given to the very people who are naturally better at fighting this disease anyway. Of course, this will give the illusion that the drug is better than it actually is. If we really want an answer to whether or not this drug is effective overall, we need to account for the skewed drug distribution. We can now see that this drug actually decreases your chances of recovering for all sexes. It's scary to think that earlier, we came to the exact opposite conclusion by looking at the immediate numbers. You can actually get the wrong answer by just considering the bare totals. Now, you know that these statistics are made up. They have been specifically crafted to illustrate Simpson's paradox. The scientists running real drug trials will, hopefully, not let this happen. Wherever could this paradox possibly occur in the real world, where all experiments are under careful control? Well, it did happen in the real world, but not in a controlled environment. In the 1970s, grad school admissions to the University of California, Berkeley showed a disturbing trend. Male applicants had a significantly better chance at being accepted than female applicants. The university was charged for gender discrimination, but statisticians noticed a problem with this data. Since admittance decisions are made at the department level, let's break up the acceptance rates for men and women into each department. If you look closely, most departments actually had higher acceptance rates for women compared to men. If you look carefully, there is a skewed distribution. Most of these men just happened to apply to the departments which were easier to get into. So, naturally, they had better overall chances of acceptance. Most of these women just happened to apply to departments which were harder to get into. Therefore, they generally had overall lower chances. If we account for this gender department imbalance, we can see that there was no bias against women after all. In fact, our corrections show acceptance rates which are more or less even, if you ignore the teeny tiny bias against men that ended up popping out. The charges for discrimination were dropped. In short, numbers are tools. They can objectively reveal surprising patterns in the world, but as with any tool, they must be used carefully. Numbers will always show objective patterns, but it is up to us to see exactly what these patterns actually mean. You've just seen today how Simpson's paradox can reveal how fragile we are to misinterpreting airtight calculations. In the end, numbers really cannot lie, but we can certainly use numbers to lie to ourselves.